Yeah. Hey everyone, welcome to LWA Book Club. We discuss books that are around letters or mail or the post office on a quarterly basis. This time we kind of broke our rules, but we'll explain in a couple minutes why. Donovan, would you like to introduce yourself?
Hi, I'm Donovan. I'm one of the co-founders of the Letter Writers Alliance with Kathy over there. This is our guest, Mary Robinette Kowal. She's a puppeteer and an author and all other types of fun things.
Those are the two main ones.
Yeah.
For now, for purposes of today.
That's all that fits on the business card. And today our book is A Nurse at the Front, the war diary of First World War Diaries of Sister Edith Appleton. It is not a letter or a collection of letters. However, it is a collection of diaries, and we are of the opinion that a diary is a letter you have written to yourself.
Not only that, but in the introduction, they stated that Sister Edith actually intended for the journals to be for her mother, which is odd considering what she put in it, but we'll talk about that later. So I just thought it was an interesting take on the journals themselves. But yeah, and the reason that we chose this book, well, actually Mary chose the book because she used it for her most recent publication, which is Ghost Talkers. And I have not read it yet. I'm sorry, Mary.
That's okay.
I've read it. It's great.
Everyone who tweets about it, yeah, everyone who tweets about it's like, it's so sad. I'm like, I don't know if I'm ready for that yet.
I mean, it's a World War One novel.
I know. I
will tell you,
the book club is not about my book.
No. Okay.
Yeah. So
it's not nearly as sad as some other things that I've read that you've written.
So. I don't think it's actually any sadder than this.
Yeah.
Yeah. Is there anything else you want to say about yourself?
This is not real blood on my hands, just in case anyone is worried about me. I have come straight from the theater where I am working on puppets for a show called Diamond Dogs here in Chicago. And this is puppet blood.
When does Diamond Dogs open?
It opens a week from today, although we have some previews this week if people are in Chicago and want to come, but come next week.
Yeah, before we started the broadcast, we were actually researching what color a bladder was because
I had to build one
for
today.
Reasons. Yeah. No spoilers.
Yeah. Because puppet blood.
Puppet blood, puppet bladders.
Yeah.
Okay. It's my life.
Pretty all right. So
I think Sister Edith knew what color a bladder was.
Oh my God.
Sure. Lord Although she almighty. Doesn't tend to, there's very little viscera talk.
That's true.
There is.
In the book.
I'm very surprised at how she does not detail that stuff, but it's possibly because she's been dealing with it all day, so why do you want to write about it?
Yeah. I saw the word bedpan once.
Hmm. Well, see, she wouldn't have had to deal with the bedpans. They had orderlies to deal with those, so that wasn't part of her daily life.
Yeah. I did look up a couple of things she mentioned, which then left me into this rabbit hole of World War One injuries and wounds and all that kind of stuff.
You don't want to go down that rabbit hole.
I knew somewhat about it because I was listening to Dan Carlin's Hardcore History and I wrote it down because I always forget, the Blueprint for Armageddon.
Mm.
Which
That's
is
a good one.
It's really good, guys. If you like the stuff in this book, you want to listen to that podcast. I think it's six pieces.
I don't know, but they're hours and hours long. Also, if you're more interested in the First World War, there's a really good YouTube channel called The Great War, which goes week by week in the war, like through the years, and does sort of a news show almost on it, which is really informative for me. And I would recognize names from this book, and I'd be like, oh, yeah. That's how that's written, and I'm never going to say it right in my head.
Yeah.
Yeah, there was a lot of that.
Yeah, there was one in particular that I wasn't sure what she was saying. She was calling it gas gangrene, and I assumed that they were using the term gangrene loosely, like it was from the boys being attacked by gas.
Mm-hmm.
And then I looked it up. I'm like, oh, no, it's awful. It's gangrene that it manifests differently where there's gas trapped underneath the skin.
Yeah.
don't look those up. No. Don't look up those photos. It's awful. And the fact that she had to, that was probably one of the least things she's had to deal that were, that was awful. And I can't believe that she continued to have her humor and wit every single time she sat down to write.
That was the thing that really impressed me with these, with this book when I started reading it, was how she could talk about something that was horrifying and then in the very next sentence talk about a beautiful thing. And I, sorry, all of these sticky tabs are from when I was using it for research, but there was this one that I thought that really kind of captured for me a lot of what the entire book was about. May I?
Mm-hmm.
My poor ill boy did not manage to get away yesterday. And by get away, she means die. But he is terribly feverish and weak and keeps coughing up stuff from fresh abscesses. As soon as one dies off, another starts. Lena Ashwell's concert party were here and gave us a charming selection of songs and violin and piano pieces. And I'm just like, and it's this contrast for me between the what is her daily horror and her, it feels like a conscious effort to find beauty.
Yeah, she definitely goes, I just realized we didn't have the microphone, guys, so I'm sorry. But
you probably could still hear us.
Oh, yeah. Probably just not as awesome as it normally is. So let me see. I noticed that they did a lot of like plays and theater acts for the boys, which I thought was really cool.
I was surprised by how much they ate. It seemed like they ate well, a lot.
Well, the hospitals, and it depends on where you were too.
Yeah.
But yeah. I was also
just in people's houses. Like they would just hurt. What struck me about her so much is that you could tell she was aristocracy.
Mm-hmm.
And because she would just show up in people's houses and expect tea. It was a different, like, okay.
But you know, I'll say that my grandmother would talk about this. Grandma died when she was 109, just 2 years ago. She was born in 1905. And one of the things that she talked about all the time about being frustrated with telephones was that you had to call ahead to let someone know. And she was definitely, like, grandma was married to a hog farmer. There was a point in, you know, when my mom was a child when they actually had literal dirt floor. So definitely not aristocracy. But she said, you know, if you showed up at someone's house and it was around a mealtime, they would just feed you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so I'm not sure that that's an aristocracy trick.
You're right.
Marker.
I will say my father is the same way. My father does not call ahead and he will just show up at your house.
Do you feed him tea?
If you're eating, he's eating too.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, my grandmother told me, cause I was telling her about, so I had gone to an exhibition at the Smart Museum and they had a Serbian artist there that was serving sweet cherry liquor. And they said, oh, it's traditional to serve it to guests. So, and my grandmother's Serbian, so I asked her about it. She's like, oh yeah, you always had to have that on hand. You had something sweet and something sour to offer every single person who walked in your house, no matter what time of day it was.
Wow.
And I was like, okay, well then. Yeah, so they just had to be prepared all the time for yeah, extra people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. She made me hungry frequently, though.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, the thing where she was talking about going to the gardens and watching the I think it was peonies were blooming. It was just, I thought, one of the most beautifully evocative sections.
She was extremely good at describing nature.
Mm-hmm.
To the point where, like, oh yeah, sometimes she would draw in her journals. I'm like, she didn't need it.
Mm-mm.
Like, the drawings did nothing for me. You know, I was like, oh, she can also draw, kind of. That's cool. But I mean, her words painted the picture way better than her drawings did. And I was just very surprised at how well she was able to describe all that stuff.
Let's speak in more generalities about the book, I guess. Did you enjoy it?
I did. And like you, it took me a while to get through. So Donovan had told me, I was like, hey, you know, we got book club in a week. And she's like, no, it's not in a week. I'm like, yeah, it is. Check your calendar. She's like, there's no way I'm going to get through this. And I'll let you talk about this later. But it took, like, I had to take breaks.
Yeah.
right? Like I couldn't just read it all in one sitting, except for like halfway through, I couldn't stop reading it. I think it might have been when the boy was dying, and I'm like, no, I need to know.
Yes, yes, yes. I was like, he's still alive. He's still alive.
I was like, maybe he can make it. And then, and then in one of the footnotes, they mentioned him in past tense, and I was like, ah, he didn't make it. I already know he didn't make it because the stupid footnote gives it away. But like the footnotes I found were extremely helpful.
Yes.
I wanted way more footnotes.
Yes. Oh yeah. I mean, I think that the ones that they gave were very good. Yeah. And I agree. I could use more, but yeah, I had to do it in small breaks. And when I first started out, I was like, I don't know if I'm gonna be able to finish this one. Like it's very, yeah, it's very visceral.
Well, but it's also, it's sort of that because it's a diary and it's sort of a day to day, I feel the passage of time when I read, and the war never seemed so long to me before I read this book. And it's not even the entire war.
Yeah.
It's missing great swaths.
Yeah.
And I was just like, will the war ever end? I don't know. I don't know if it's ever going to end.
It's so funny because I'm reading it and I know when it ends, but while I was reading it, I was like, when is it going to happen? Like, yeah. You know, like I know the date, but even in reading them, I was like, when, you know? So, yeah. And
I was really struck by the fact that, like, right before, like, I know peace is coming. A, I'm near the end of the book. B, I live in the future.
Right.
But by the time people have sort of resigned themselves to war never ceasing, they're like, oh, it's going to go on for at least 2 more years. Like, 2 weeks later, there's peace.
Yeah.
Like, meanwhile, all before this is just over by Christmas.
Over by Christmas. Yeah.
Over by Christmas. Yeah, yeah,
yeah. It was always Christmas. It didn't matter what year it was.
Yeah.
Christmas this year. Yeah. Yeah, that was, I was reading it for research, but I also had that sense of, at a certain point, not wanting to put it down.
Mm-hmm.
I think for me, some of the reason also that sense of time passing at the beginning, the reason that I didn't want to keep reading was actually because I was almost reading it like letters, that I needed some subjective time to pass, or objective time. I needed time to pass, literal time to pass for me before I could keep going.
Mm-hmm.
But it's, yeah, I was just really taken by her.
Yeah, she, because she was a real person, and she feels very real. I like how she can be compassionate, and she can be judgmental, and she can have something nasty to say about a coworker and something nice to say about a German prisoner of war. And she felt very complex because of that.
Yeah.
I mean, but she's real, and I'm talking about her like a fictional character, but yeah.
Yeah.
She's also a badass.
Yeah.
Dude, like, the fact that she was going bathing, that she was just like, oh, those mines in the water, they're bothering me, like, they're not letting me, you know, like, all, like, and then the part where I was like, I didn't think she can get any more badass, is towards the end, and on this edition, it's to page 288, where she's chasing after the train that left her.
Yeah.
And she's considering, okay, so we're thinking about climbing under it, but then it began to move, so then we hopped on it, and I'm just like, she's doing this in, like, full Victorian dress and heels.
Yeah. Well, she was at, okay, so here's where my nerdery comes in.
Okay.
Yes, she was doing this in full Victorian dress, but technically Edwardian by this point.
Mm-hmm.
But that means that she had on stout boots.
Okay.
So they were fairly low and sensible heels.
Okay.
If she had heels.
Right.
She may have actually been wearing flats. And her skirt would have been somewhere between ankle and tee length.
Yeah, but she would still be wearing some restrictive clothing, correct? Like a corset?
The corseting was not so bad.
Okay.
And also these women were probably not lacing particularly tightly because they were having to dress themselves.
Yeah.
But a properly made corset is like one that you're used to wearing all the time.
Yeah.
Is not. Like I have worn contemporary garments that are far more restrictive of movement. I mean, you can see on the cover that the things that they're wearing are not, I mean, they're way more restrictive than anything that I wear today. But they're not that bad.
Yeah, I just kind of imagine chasing a train down wearing that. Though.
Yeah.
Or like, and like considering to go under a train. I wouldn't go under a train.
No.
Wearing clothing now. Like,
yeah. It's actually, again,
yeah,
in the.
I'm trying to catch it, I might.
Yeah.
Yeah. In the random things that Mary researches, in my novel, I had to have a character crawling in a skirt. Turns out it's actually easier to do if it's below the knee than if it isn't. Because above the knee, they tend to be fairly tight and very restrictive, and they creep up.
Mm.
And below the knee, they actually act as padding. And,
yeah, I see that.
And, you know, you also just grab it and hike it up. But it's, right. Yeah, going under the train, I had that same.
Yeah, I was like, what? Whoa, dude. But she's pretty, like, fit. Like,
yeah.
She would go walking all the time. She would go swimming all the time.
Well, and manhandling men.
Oh, yeah. I'm sure those guys were not, like.
No.
I have done very, 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 very little nursing work, and lifting a person is very hard.
Yeah.
Especially when they cannot help you.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Yeah, and lifting them without hurting them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. No, I think all nurses in general are pretty badass.
I think that she got sick maybe twice, that she wrote in the journals, because there was a big swath of. Journals missing. Yeah. And she said, oh, I got sick because this is what happens when you can't go out for a walk. I'm like, it's November. You know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
No. She was not fooling around.
Yeah.
I found very amusing the holdovers of propriety within the book. Like at one point she beds down for the night in an empty ward, and like they think that there's nobody in there, and like an officer goes to sleep in there too, and she's terrified that they will find out that she's in there too. And she's like,
yeah.
This is not important.
No.
And you guys are really concerned.
Yeah. And at the same time, then she'll tell like a totally bawdy story, like the which I also marked in here, the one about the officer that they were going to bury.
Oh yeah.
Hammered and screwed.
Yes. And I'm just like, wait, did you just tell it? You did just tell that joke. Okay.
Yeah. And it's interesting to me because
the rules
that they would have. They would continue to have rules for class within officers in a hospital. I was
yeah.
Like, everyone should be okay.
Yeah, but this
but
is.
But again, that may be. An American outlook on it.
No, that was
a Victorian outlook.
It's definitely modern versus this era. But World War I was one of the reasons for the class breakdown, or the beginning of the dissolving of the class barriers, because of that kind of thing. Because they were like, look, we're all going out here and getting shot. And the other thing that happened in World War I was in the Battle of the Somme in particular, which she is at, is with all the men going over the top because all of the officers were trained to stand up so they would, most of the officers were the first people to die.
Mm.
And so then they were having to promote from within the ranks, which means that lower class men who always, oh, I shouldn't say always, but frequently had significantly more service than the guys did, than the gentry. So it started, that's part of what started that whole class breakdown, but it was still like, it is still so embedded in things.
Yeah. There's one part where she was just like, all these Tommies came in. Thankfully, no officers.
Yeah.
I was like, oh, they must be a real pain in the ass to take care of or something.
Yes.
So, yeah, I don't, that was funny to me.
At one point, she writes that she, because she likes to write about how many different people from different places are around. Like, oh, we have 2 South Americans, we have 3 New Zealanders, 5 Chinamen, and she writes that they have 2 types of Americans, and she doesn't go into what types of Americans they have. I'm just wondering which she means.
I wonder if it was officers and...
No, because she's talking about nurses.
Oh. Oh, I missed that completely.
dog eared it.
I have too many. I had to like, I have dog ears, but then I also have a list of things I definitely
Oh, you know what? It might be. It's not nurses.
Oh, okay. Oh.
In my ward, I have two sorts of Americans. Now we have a Canadian as well as English, Scottish, and Irish.
So I don't know if she means by nationality or temperament, because she mentioned later that there were two kinds of Americans, the kinds that drink and the kind that are nice.
Oh.
So I wonder if she's referencing that.
Okay.
That could be.
Because she was just like, some of them are just awful, basically, is what she said.
Right, because temperance societies were happening right now.
Yeah.
So that could be.
I also really liked.
I love how she counted how many cigarettes she had.
Yes.
I was like, what? Which surprised me, because she shouldn't be, like, in her society, she shouldn't be smoking anyways, because she's
This was, so again, remember that this is when suffrage is going on. So
yeah.
Actually there were a lot more women smoking now than you would expect there to be. But also she's at the front, and cigarettes are a form of currency.
Oh yeah. Did you notice in the beginning she kept saying, like, why won't they just put me back on the front?
Oh yeah.
So why was,
why did she like that?
Why
so
did
much?
She like the front so much? Like, why did she want to be there so badly? I didn't get that.
I think this is just speculation, but I think it's because she always had something to do there, mm-hmm. and it was always just, they would triage the men, they would pack them up, they would send them out,
mm-hmm.
and like she didn't have to deal constantly with like the convalescent care, which she seems to do fine with, but I just think she liked to be busy.
Yeah.
And I really like that she likes to be alone as well.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
She's always so miffed when, like, somebody she doesn't like wants to tag along on her walks.
No love interest. Oh, my God. I was so excited about right. No love interest. Because it's like, if you're going to read letter-type books, it's always a romance book.
Right.
And we've done, like, 3 romance books in a row, and I'm just like, oh, God, just give me something without a love interest. And there might have been, like, 2 dudes that I was like, maybe she likes that guy. But who cares?
There was an older guy that kept getting on her about getting married, and she was like, no, I'm too old. But if you read the beginning,
yeah.
She does get married.
She ends
to
up
a
getting
younger man.
Mm-hmm. And
who dies.
He dies first or something, yeah. too. So, yeah.
Whatever.
Yeah. So that made me excited that there was no love interest at all. And then, I want to see what the other notes, and the fact that wherever she was, she made an effort to see the local landmarks or try
mm-hmm.
to learn customs. So like she was doing the lace making.
Yeah.
And I thought that was really cool that she was trying to get to know, like, she's like, I'm only going to be here once probably. And I might as well get to see everything. And I might as well get to learn about the people here, which I think is really cool.
Yeah.
Also, lace making's hard.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it's like, this is the thing I'm going to do to relax. I'm going to take my lace pillow and just, like, tie little tiny knots.
That's not relaxing.
No.
No. But then I also knit to relax, so.
Which is also tying little tiny knots, really.
Yeah. Yeah, but the yarn's not like this. Like,
no, I know.
You know?
She speaks to me. She always needs to do something.
Yes.
She's always busy.
Oh, man.
And she doesn't like crowds of people.
Yeah.
I have one note here, but I can't read what it is. But I'm sorry. Is there something else that you guys thought specific things?
Oh, on page 80, which is where you get the first, like, scan of an actual page.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm used to reading really terrible handwriting because I work in a doctor's office. And so I'm reading her words, and I am discovering how much editing has gone into this book.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And that bugs me.
Yeah. I was annoyed by that.
I really wish I was just reading photocopies.
Yeah.
Or just reading transcribed words.
I noticed that in, can't remember, it wasn't the first scan. I think it was the second scan, and it was the first page, and it almost mimicked what was on the spread. And I was like, that's not what that says.
And the
and
editor
really
will move sentences around.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I get why. Like, I can understand why that editing choice might be made. But at the same time, I appreciate that more
mm-hmm.
because it it's just so much more genuine. The way people edit themselves is really telling about who they are.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And yeah, I don't know. It loses something in the translation.
Yeah.
Yeah, it made me wonder what else was cut out, because I think it's
this
one. Well,
it's more the,
it
it's
is
more
this
the
one.
Stuff
yeah.
that's added
and
in.
There was something here that I actually couldn't read the text. So I was like, oh, let me look over here and see what she's actually saying. I'm like, oh, it's not there.
Mm-hmm.
So where is it?
Yeah.
So, yeah, I was not a fan of that.
No.
There's one point, let me see, this is...
Because these are, when you read the actual handwritten notes, they are much more note-like. And
yeah.
It feels like something, yeah, she's been at work all day.
Mm-hmm.
She's using a little bit of shorthand on her own. She's not using connecting words.
Like, yeah.
And yeah, so.
Yeah, I was just like, this is the one, they don't include it over here at all.
No, it's cut out. And
yeah.
I was like, and I couldn't read what it was actually saying. And
they
seemed
a sad little group at, and that must be French. At the home.
Mm-hmm.
And I was sorry to leave them. There was very little work being done. And why don't they?
Looks like
why
sick something.
Sick.
The home.
Oh, yeah. Done. And why don't they? And why they don't close both places remains a mystery. I did not proceed at once.
That part, the not proceeding at once, they definitely included that.
Yeah. No,
but
they did.
Well,
yeah.
I did not proceed at once is up here.
Yeah.
They cut a significant
yeah.
portion
yeah.
out. Yeah. So
that bugged me.
Yeah.
Yeah. So there was one point, July 6, 1960, page 162, where there was too many patients. And she was keeping track of like how many train loads were coming.
Oh,
and they're
the
like,
train
we
loads.
Just, and like
yeah.
they didn't even, they, or they said, like, oh, expect this many people. And it's like, they didn't even tell us, they just said full train. And that's it. And then they're talking about how they're leaving the boys outside. And thank goodness that it's nice weather because, God, you know. And I just,
yeah.
like, they do include a photo of a bunch of infirmed men lined up in stretchers outside, like, earlier on. And I just, God, I just couldn't imagine, you know, like, feeling that... You're outside. You're like out of all that time that you've been in the trenches
yeah.
and you're injured. Don't you just want a freaking roof over your head? Like,
yeah. And that wasn't possible. Like 13,
yeah.
you know, the fact that the hospital had 1300 beds and they were all full and the trains just
kept
coming. And that was one of the things like you were saying that this made me more aware of the weight of the war was just her, the constant.
Yeah.
Constant stream of wounded.
Yeah. I mean, I kind of had an idea of it because of the Dan Carlin podcast, because he references to the war several times as a meat grinder.
Mm-hmm.
Like, just keep throwing men at it, keep throwing bodies at
but
it.
But he doesn't even touch on convalescence.
No.
Yeah.
At all.
Mm-mm.
He only talks about pushes and...
Yeah. And she says a few times, like, oh, this boy lost half of his face or something like
yeah.
that. And because of Boardwalk Empire, I know about, like, the shrapnel thing about how it can you can screw up your face and whatnot. And I was like, you know what? I need to be reminded about what shrapnel looks like because I apparently like to punish myself. And so I looked it up, and I was just like, my God. And then, you know, they were saying that even though a large population that did survive and came back home, people still didn't even want to accept them, even though there's a large portion of people in the population that looked like that.
Yeah.
And that they had, one thing I read was that they had park benches that were specifically made for wounded warriors so that people, and they painted them a specific color, I can't remember what color, like blue or something, so that when people saw someone sitting on that bench, they could prepare themselves to view upon them. I'm like, are you freaking serious?
They were, the Victorians and Edwardians were delicate wilting flowers.
God. I mean, it's not pretty to look at.
Because
but...
they convinced themselves to be.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I think that one of the doctors she worked with, I looked up his name, he was one of the people who started plastic surgery.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you, when you look up the people who were getting like their face redone, he did this weird thing where he'll take like a flap of your skin and then bring it down here to like try to, it's like for the first skin graft, because you have to keep the blood in there. And it's like really interesting.
Yeah.
Very, very interesting. But this is why after the war was over, she kept talking about all these boys like still staying around, because they were going through. And apparently, like, if you wanted to do a full facial reconstruction, it's like 3 years. So the war's over. They can't go home. I couldn't even imagine being in that position. And they're not even going to look like themselves when they're done.
Yeah.
So, and I think she says it might have been better off than just dying or something.
Yeah, there's a number of them that she makes references like that to. And
the ones that attempt to kill themselves when they know that they've been grievously injured, and they still survive that, and then they're going to be charged for trying to kill themselves. And
oh,
like, but nobody would blame them.
I don't think she was. I thought that the self-harm ones were the guys on the trenches just trying to get out of the war, like, period.
There's
two types.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, there's a specific one she mentions that like tries to cut his own throat after he's been blown up like twice, and he doesn't think anybody's coming to get him.
So that's fun.
Yeah.
Let me see now. Oh, and then on a lighter note, 201, she says something about, hang on. I wanted to ask you about this because I was hoping maybe you had done research on this. October 12th, we've had a convoy of about 400 bad cases, 53 English and 2 Germans, who were sent to the Canadian hospital. And the last line is, it made them gibber the cowards because they are terrified of the Canadians. Why would you be terrified of a Canadian? I was just like, what's going on here?
Fierce warriors.
That's interesting.
I know that the Canadians ended up joining a little later, so maybe they were fresher and more like less ground down.
Before the Americans
maybe,
did.
Maybe
for
the
sure.
maybe the medical care is worse. I don't know, honestly.
I like how she would write Australians.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because
that's how they say it.
Yeah.
I was trying to explain that to Dylan, and he thought I was saying that the Australians did not want to be confused with the Austrians. And I was like, no.
It's just, she's writing down the accent.
Yeah.
Australian. International Lunatic Asylum.
Oh, man. The part where she was like, in a fancy posh hotel.
Mm-hmm.
Let me just acknowledge that for a second.
Yes.
Oh man.
Yeah.
It's interesting that they, you know, they make them wear the like nun hats, but they don't really seem to be nuns. They call them sisters.
Yeah, that was.
But they don't do like she talks about everybody's a padre. Sometimes they're a Jewish padre. Sometimes they're an Episcopalian padre.
Yeah.
But it seems like church is like a, you go or you don't. It never seems like you have to go. And
it was just the uniform of the day.
Yeah.
And the convention. And there's still places where they call nurses sisters, even if they are, even if they're not nuns.
Mm.
It's just curious. It was a curious thing. I was just like, hmm.
Mm-hmm.
I also found it odd. I don't know if it's because her brother joined later, but I found it odd that we didn't hear about her brother until like way later, like almost 1917. I was just like, huh.
And he's also with the New Zealanders.
Yeah, he's with the New Zealanders.
That's where he lives.
Yeah, and so
he like moved to New Zealand.
I don't know. I don't know when New Zealand joined. Like, I know they started. I know that the British started pulling in the colonies when they started running out of guys.
Yeah,
but I don't know if that's because that we don't hear about him until New Zealand actually joins. Or what, you know?
Yeah, I don't know. Because my book was set in 1916, there's a certain aspect of, if it happens after 1916, I didn't care.
Right, yeah.
But I don't remember when New Zealand joined. I will also say, though, that if you like this book and want to, there's a series called, is it The Girls of Anzac? Anyway, it's about the Australian and New Zealand nurses.
Hmm.
It's beautifully shot, and it's World War I, and it's basically Sister Edith. I mean, it's not, but it is very much of this time, and there are sections out there that are shot in the Somme. So really a real overlap and beautiful, and like this tragic, but there are romances because TV.
Yeah, Margaret Landis in the chat said that Canadians and Anzacs were getting killed all the time in the Middle East at that same time.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, hi, Margaret.
Yeah. Which, if Margaret can tell me in the chat, I saw on Instagram that you were also watching a movie, Crimson something, about World War I. So if you can remind me what that movie was, to get ready for today. So we were talking about how, like, she's witty and she tends to write about nature a lot and everything. And one thing I found that was interesting is that you don't really see her break until almost 4 years into it. And I, like, it was so surprising to me that I was like, what the hell's going on? It's August 27th. So it's like, what, 3 months until the war ends? She finally loses it. And, you know, she's just saying, like, I can't take it. The war's a shambles. Every day, 2 or 3 train loads come through. And she's like completely, like, I've never seen her so upset in her writing before.
Yeah.
And then she says, hold on. We're getting hundreds of Boches, is that how they pronounce it?
I said Bosch.
Bosch, okay. Many mortally wounded, so no time for me or such things as diaries. If they were, I would just say how pretty the sea and the sky are this morning. Blue and copper! Like, she still has to put it in! I love how she's like, I would say this, but whatever, it's just blue and copper. So, like, and I almost feel like it was a sarcasm, like, her being sarcastic about herself. And I was just like, I wish I could be as tough as nails as this woman is.
Yeah.
Because I would have lost it 2 years in. And she talks about how some of the nurses are they're getting nervy.
Mm-hmm.
And she's like, I think early on, maybe like a year in, she was like, I'm getting kind of nervy, foolish person that I am. I'm like, no, not foolish.
And jumping, just because of these guns going off all the time.
Yeah. Oh, which was interesting, her saying like, oh, we heard some guns, but it's probably like bar or something.
Yeah. Well, because you could hear them all the time.
Yeah. But how they would just go out and look at it. I mean, it's so interesting, and it's happening today. Like, people have to still live in war zones.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's like, well,
what are you going to do?
You don't stop.
Yeah. And that was one of the things, I think, again, why I feel like she was making a kind of deliberate choice to focus on the beautiful things.
Yeah.
Because she, at a certain point, you wind up normalizing all of the horror around you.
Right.
And so it's like, oh, okay, let me find something that is not this.
Yeah.
Or like, I mean, this is a very prosaic, mundane example, but the way you can look at a beautiful landscape and go, oh, this is so beautiful. And you pick up your camera to take a picture and then realize that there are telephone lines everywhere, which you had completely edited out.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that to a certain degree that they all started editing out.
The telephone lines? The guns.
I think that's she actually stops talking about the guns, is that she kind of stops hearing them.
Right.
Unless they're really notably loud.
It's like living next to a train.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was thinking the telephone lines is more like the noise, right?
Yeah.
So, let me read what Margaret wrote so I can remember. Oh, The Crimson Field, it's a TV show, PBS, BBC,
yes,
about World War I nurses. Every episode could almost be taken directly from the diary. So according to Anzac, Wikipedia page, they were mostly in the Middle East Mesopotamian theater until later in the war. So Edith may not have brought up her brother because she didn't expect to run into him. It was so interesting to me about how every single person who from New Zealand, she's like, have you seen my brother?
She runs into one.
Yeah. I do remember what I was going to say, which is that, you know, letters do make a very interesting point of life, because she's often mentions writing to the mothers or writing to the wives.
Yes. So many of them come to visit.
Yeah. Towards the end,
get there?
I think towards the end they just started coming. I think in the beginning they just weren't doing it. But I mean,
well, she was more on the front at the very beginning.
Yeah, that's true. But I mean, think about it. England and France are really close. So,
they are.
You know, why not? Hey, yeah. My son's probably going to die. It's going to be the last time I ever see him. Why don't I go over?
Yeah.
But that's not something I ever considered.
I'm sure the nurses didn't appreciate it.
No, they seem. I mean, she didn't seem annoyed, but then she doesn't really ever seem to get annoyed, which is part of why she's really great.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that a lot of the women who were coming over would then take over the nursing care for their son, which is okay. One of the reasons that,
yeah.
And it's a little bit different from, well, actually even in modern hospitals, they tend to like it when there's family there because, mm-hmm.
They're being watched.
They're yeah. being watched and there's someone who can deal with, let me get you some water.
Right. Yeah. All the little stuff. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, but I found it because of the fact she was writing these letters to family members, I found it surprising that she didn't, in her journal, she didn't seem to get attached until the boy came. It took so long for her to get attached to someone.
Yeah, I think some of it is just that a lot of them died really fast.
Yeah.
And
got sent on.
Yeah, they were in and out of her hair a lot.
Yeah.
Just sort of a, this one goes to England, this one goes here, this one goes back to the front. Like.
Yeah. But yeah.
They either lived or died.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But he was there for weeks.
Yeah.
A really long time, and then she wouldn't talk about him for a couple entries. I was like, so yeah, but I just found it interesting it took her that long. So I don't know if she just was so good at separation or if it's what you guys are saying that, you know, they just were moving out so fast.
And there were also, thousands of them. I was thinking about what you were talking about with her not getting annoyed. And one of my favorite sections was actually when she is talking about people that she gets annoyed by, which is the VADs.
Oh, yeah, her helpers.
Yes.
Sometimes they can.
Yes.
Yeah.
Roughly divided into four sorts: stalkers, crawlers, the irresponsible butterflyers, and the sturdy pushers. At the moment, I'm thinking of a butterfly who is on night duty in these wards and says with a lighthearted laugh, "It's ripping, nursing men, great fun. When I was in the officer's ward, I did the housework all the time, great fun. But the men here are really ill, great fun." When I show her how to do anything fresh, she twitches to get at it and says, "Oh, do let me try, I'd love to do it, simply love to." And then the stalkers are nicest girls. She says nice girls, but yeah. Then she's like very lordly with high-pitched, crackly voices. That does not sound nice.
Well, I also would have to keep reminding myself, though, that words then have different meanings than they do now. Like, she uses pathetic a lot, and it does not have the same connotation today that it did then.
No, that's
what
true.
What did it have then?
It was a lot kinder of a word.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, like, condescension was a much kinder word.
Yeah.
She did met the one people she did get annoyed with were the drivers, ambulance drivers.
Yeah.
And she was I don't remember where it was, but she was talking about once, like, being surprised that nurses actually did work. Like, they thought that the drivers did all the work. And I'm like, it's not anyone, though.
Yeah.
Like, you always think you're the one that's working hardest.
Yeah. I think that's why she speaks to me, because she really doesn't, form strong attachments necessarily to other people. She can get annoyed by these other people working with her, but she never seems to bring that annoyance to the patients.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's true.
And she only seems to get annoyed if somebody's not doing their job correctly.
Yes. That's true.
Like, she feels bad for the lady that has to turn in the nurses that were dancing.
Oh, yeah.
And she's like, this is why I don't want to be in charge, because I don't have to tattle on people.
Yeah. Which is
which speaks to the fact that she would.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
She doesn't want to, therefore.
Yeah.
Doesn't want to be in charge.
She mentions later on, too, that, like, the British nurses weren't allowed to dance, but the American ones were. And she just thought that was stupid. Like, she's just like, what's the deal with that? You know, because I think that a couple of British nurses did end up dancing.
Yeah, and they got
with no. Like, later on. She mentions, like, I hope that no one saw that, because I'm not going to.
Well, no, there was a whole conspiracy where she and the other, like, assistant matron in charge were like, we're just not going to go if there's going to be dancing, because then we won't see it.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then
yeah.
We won't have to report it.
Right. Yeah. That is, yeah. One of the nature bits that I liked a lot was she was taking tea with an officer in a cave. She mentioned
the
how
sea
you could,
caves.
Yeah, she's yeah. like, you can fit like 1,000 people in these caves. And we just sat there and watched the sunset. And I was just like, that sounds awesome.
Yeah.
I don't have any caves that I could just wander into and just have food in there. That's insane. So.
I like how brandy and whiskey were medicinal.
They are.
They are, dude. They continue to be to this day. That's why we're drinking whiskey right now.
Whiskey in my tea. There is tea in the tea as well, but there's also whiskey. It's been a day.
I gave her aspirin and a good tot of whiskey after treating the ear, and the last I heard of her was heavy snoring. Whiskey is good stuff.
Whiskey is good stuff.
Yeah.
I support that 100%. There's something else in here that I was kind of in love with. Now I've forgotten it. I mean, there was just so much.
It was
when she's Benedictine.
Oh yeah, the Benedictine facility. The bottling plant.
Yeah, going to where see Benedictine is made. I'm like, I would totally go on these adventures with you.
Oh my god, yeah. And I was it made me half wonder, is it still like that? Do they still do it the same exact way? And I never got a chance. This is another reason it took me a while to read this book, because I was like, I wonder if, and then I'd be like, all right. and then every once in a while she'd describe certain battles or whatever, and in my head, I'm not very good with timeline, so in my head I was like, I think that's one that happened, and I'd have to go look it up, and then World War One photos.
Because she got,
of course she got them wrong. Yeah, she was just there in real time. No, but it was more like me trying to figure out, okay, in my timeline, what do I have wrong, and what do I need to switch up in my head? Because my preferred historical nerdiness is World War II, so I'm not really a World War One person.
And well, I had to look up turns of phrase. Mm-hmm. Like at some point she talks about drawing a veil over something.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, don't entirely know what that means.
What does it mean?
So it had to do with a football match between English and somebody else. And she was like, and then we'll draw a veil about that. And it means to not speak about a topic.
Oh, right. Because they didn't decide who won. That's right. They said that they didn't know who won, and everyone was like, we just played.
Yeah.
Which I thought was really cool how much they decorated the rooms
for
them.
Yeah.
And they showed a photo of one of the halls being decorated, and I was like, wow, that's actually really nice.
Yeah. That's
so
a lot of work.
Banners and everything. And they did
it every year, because she talks about making paper flowers one Christmas, and the other Christmases, she's like, you're putting on plays. And
right. Yeah. And then the egg and spoon race, which I've tried
to do more than once.
I tried to do that once, and I'm not good.
It's not easy. No, it's not.
They talk about practicing.
Yeah.
And doing it in a skirt.
Oh, yeah. And then
how somebody wasn't allowed to do it because they didn't think it was proper.
The head nurse at the time said that her ward wasn't allowed to do it. And they were like, we've been practicing this whole time, and now we can't even do it. She got really upset about it. But, yeah, I mean, I just the main takeaway for me from this book was you can maintain your sanity and have humor in a really shitty time.
Yeah.
She's living proof of that. And it was really, really nice to read. That's possible. So.
Did you learn? I mean, I definitely did, but did you learn things about the war you didn't know?
Oh yeah, for sure. There was the time that she was saying that her friend was on a train and that they had to sleep in ditches when there were patients in the train at nighttime. And it was very small details. We're like, initially, I'd be like, why would they have to do that? All right, the train got attacked. And stuff you wouldn't think about, you know?
Yeah, it was all the little tiny everyday details, the kind of things that you do put into a diary or into a letter that you don't put into a novel necessarily.
Yeah.
Or a history book.
That's what I'm saying, it's a history book. So you're not going to write about how the nurses had to sleep in ditches, which I was like, that's lame.
Yeah.
I think what stuck with me most was how German the English aristocracy is.
Oh, yeah.
Because I had no idea that Prince Albert was in Berlin because he had to be because he was part of that. Like, I had no clue.
Serious.
And, like,
drama,
I
dude.
Knew they had changed their name to Windsor, but I had no clue it was that, like, recent. And it was just so, and she talks about thinking Princess
Victoria
someone is probably a spy because her brother's fighting over in Germany. And it's just like, it's crazy.
Mm-hmm.
I'm surprised she held back as much as she did. Like, that had to have been number one juicy gossip of that time. Like, it took a while for her to even mention it. And then, yeah, I don't know. Maybe they edited it out since we're talking about that. But, yeah.
Yeah. I suspect that some of it was also, you know, the yes, you gossip about it, but then do you necessarily, like, I'm not sure that I would write the gossip down.
That's true.
Yeah. I mean, in the propaganda, watching the propaganda machine at work is really interesting.
Yeah.
To watch the rumors that do fly around.
Which,
and, like, the anti-American rumors that fly around.
Oh, yeah.
Which, speaking of gossip, I'm, like, reading, oh, you know, this soldier told me this and this soldier told me that. I'm like, how is this shit getting around? Like, how did they even win the war when this many people were talking?
You know? Yeah, like, it's supposed to be secret, but everybody knows.
Yeah. So I was just told by a soldier that there's going to be a raid in 2 days. I'm like, no one should know that. No one.
I like they find a whole notebook, one of the German people.
Oh, my God, yeah.
And she's just like, I hope the rest of them think to destroy these before they're captured.
I actually half thought that he did that on purpose. Because I think there was one of the soldiers that was, like, I think he was begging to be taken to England, and he had, like, some sympathies or something like that. And so I was like, I think he did that on purpose. I don't think it was an accident.
Yeah.
It's very curious. Really an interesting read. I'm glad we picked it.
Yeah.
Even though it's not necessarily a lecture.
No, it was great. And definitely made me think a lot. Made me...
I also found it a really good palate cleanser after all the fiction that we've been through. Like, it was nice to read some nonfiction.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, man, a badass woman doing badass stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, I love her.
Yeah, thank you for telling us about this one. It's good stuff, for sure. So, and then, since you did use this as research for your book, like, how helpful was it? Like, what aspect of your book did it help you sculpt?
So, a lot of it was the camaraderie between the women in the spiritualism circle. A lot of it was the small details, like, I think I have my main character sleeping in Sister Edith's room, because there's a point when she's in the asylum with the window that's really high up, and I've ripped that straight, totally 100% straight. I use her name in the book, but a lot of it was, there are a couple of lines. There was one in particular that I lifted more or less straight out of here, where she's talking about a young man who's dying, and he was 18 regimentally.
Mm. Oh, he lied about his age.
Yeah.
Yeah.
One of the many that had lied about his age. And so I stole some of the last words that people
would
say.
Yeah.
So that one was, tell my dad that everything's all right. I just didn't think I would die. So
He died pretty early.
Here it is. He asked me to write to his father and say it was all right. He didn't mind going. Then he said, I've done my bit, but I didn't think I should die so young. And so a composite, because that kind of thing happened multiple times. But a composite of that, it was the passing of the last words. The final messages that she and the other nurses were responsible for formed a big core of what the spirit core did in my novels. And for Wimple. Also, totally used that a lot.
Yeah. That was one thing.
The trains,
It's one thing I found interesting.
Yeah, I don't even, when I think about the war, I don't even think about the trains.
Yeah.
It's just not something that, and I do, I think it's because I've been presented all my life with images of World War II.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure that used strings.
Yeah. And
but like, that's not what you, that's not the fancy parts. That's not what you see.
I mean,
you see bombers and tanks.
She mentions it in the end where there was a train full of like bombs, or maybe it was a van, that they had burned. And some guy that was with her, like an officer, was just like, oh, that's like a million pounds worth of.
Yeah, they destroyed.
Yeah, they just destroyed. And that was how they would hit them. My great grandfather was in World War I, and he said that he kept asking for ammunition and asking for ammunition. And they finally sent him a crate, and it was oranges. And he's like, what are we going to do, throw them? So yeah, I mean, like, that's the way you attacked them, is you didn't allow the people on the front lines to have what they needed. And so that's, you would bomb the trains or do something with the tracks. And that's that's why it took her so long to travel towards the end, right? It's like, oh, we were stuck for whatever. Because XYZ. And the war wasn't even happening at that point. It was already over.
Yeah. But I mean, I like how she would talk about like being angry about people, the Belgian populace, like stealing the coal from the train.
Mm-hmm.
And then like two other entries down the line, talk about a skinny old man.
Yeah.
It's like she just, there's this nationalist fervor that she can be gripped by sometimes, and other times she has such compassion for them.
Yeah, and that was, I think the thing that for me was powerful about it is the fact that it's nonfiction, and because she was a real person, that
you feel differently different days.
Yeah. And it's nice to be reminded of that.
Yeah. I think her opinion of it also changed depending on who was taking it. You know, like, I think she got upset when the soldiers were taking it.
Yeah.
And she's just like, but you know, it's like, you're getting it another means. But if like village people were taking it, I think she seemed to be a little bit more okay with it. So, but the one, talking about what you were using for your book, like the one part that is interesting to me is like the way she was recording the men who are dying, the majority of them were so dignified. And I was, I don't know if I could have, like, if I was in their shoes, I'd have been like, fuck this bullshit thing. Like, this is crap. I'm 18. I'm not even 18. I'm like, I'd be so angry about it. But they were just not.
There's a conversation about how swearing helps them get over the trenches.
Yeah.
Like, I'm not normally a man that swears, but it really helps
get over. Yeah. So, I don't know. Yeah, this is a very, very, I think on Goodreads I gave it 4 stars. Yeah. So, I really like this a lot. And
you only give 4 stars to something you like a lot?
Dude, 5 stars for me, it means I'm going to reread it. Like, I am very weird with stars. I'm a very odd star person. But yeah, 5 books for me is like, it was life-changing, and I'm going to reread it every year. It's kind of like what that means to me.
Yeah, no, I do that too.
Yeah. So I'm very stingy.
I'm very harsh on Goodreads, so
yeah, that's fair. Yeah. So, and then 3 stars is like, you're good.
Yeah, why not? Peace.
Yeah. You didn't make me want to throw the book across the room, which our last book made me want to do.
So, you know.
It was awful. I think I gave it a pity 2 stars.
Yeah, I've heard of this book.
Yeah, so our next book, it was recommended by our member, Emily, and it is The Crime...
By Instagram, right?
By Instagram.
Yeah, feel free, send us recommendations, write us a letter about it, put it on Instagram, LWA Book Club is the hashtag.
Yeah.
We want to read with you. That's the point of a club.
Yeah. So she just took a picture of a book that she thought we should read next, and she just like held it up like this. So she's going to be our guest for the next one, since she recommended it. We're still trying to figure out a date, but it's going to be sometime in April. And it's going to be The Crying of Lot 49, which she says is really weird. Have you read that one?
Mm-mm.
Yeah. She says it's like, I would try to describe it to you, but it's really bizarre.
That sounds fun.
Yeah, yeah, I like to go into book club books super fresh, like not reading anything about it. So so that's the next one. And we'll, you know, put something up about when it actually will be in April. But go ahead.
It will
and
be
get
on
it.
Our events page.
Yeah. Go ahead and get it from your library or whatever, or buy it. So, Mary, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you so much.
Delightful to be here, always.
Yeah.
Thank you for the recommendation.
Yeah.
Thank you for your awesome books to write.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you for your letters.
So yeah, and thanks for joining us, guys. I hope you enjoyed the books, and if there's anything that you think we should read, again, recommend it to us, and we'll be happy to consider it. We also have a recommendation post on Goodreads. And then one last thing is that on Goodreads, I put a discussion forum for anyone who wants to meet locally. We currently have someone in Tucson. Is that how you pronounce that? In Arizona? Is that
Tucson.
Tucson.
Thank you. Tucson. This is what happens when you only read stuff.
Yeah, I know.
I ordered the Tuscan chicken once at a restaurant, and I will never forget now how to pronounce Tucson.
Tucson.
So, yeah.
Okay. So someone on Tucson has already like put up a post in there saying who wants to have a local gathering. So if there's anyone who wants to meet locally to talk about the books or to meet up and, you know,
and
watch us.
And we think maybe our summer book club will be an in-person book club as well.
Yeah.
So.
We're going to try to make it a live event, like real person event. So yeah. And
we're fake people right now because we're all
yeah.
Fake blood again.
Puppet blood is not fake. They're real too, Mary. Come on.
You're right.
Yeah. So thanks, guys, and have a good Sunday. Bye.
Bye.